That's awesome.
For a few moments, I would be C.M. Ward or Billy Graham, exhaust the collective store of my biblical knowledge within a couple minutes, and then quietly go back and pedal my bike. Who was the friend that believed in me, that put the call on my life? Who's the friend that believed in you, who put the call on your life, not only to follow Jesus, but to serve him? We are all products of the friendship of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
Holy Spirit helps us in our downtimes as well. Those of you who read my book, The Psalm in Your Heart, know that I went through a pretty substantive period of depression a number of years ago in my life. As I walked Balboa Island and listened to great music, I had great scripture pouring into my heart. It was the Holy Spirit who authored the scripture and helped me to journal through the Psalms that brought me into a level and steady place. Scriptures like, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Scriptures like, surely goodness and love or mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Or my very favorite from the Psalms, blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of weeping or the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. They go from strength to strength until each appears before God in Zion. I want to tell you, if you're going through a rough patch in your life, if you're going through a valley season, the Holy Spirit has not abandoned you. The Holy Spirit has not left you. If you failed in some way, the Holy Spirit has not left you. He has not abandoned you. If Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother, the Holy Spirit is that same friend who stays with you closer than a brother. These words from the scripture were not written for me alone. I will send you another of the same kind, but they were written also for you. Some of you have come to Anaheim and you feel like throwing in the towel. You lay awake at night with worry. I have good news for you. The Holy Spirit is in your corner. Somebody in the church may not be in your corner. Somebody in your family may not be in your corner. Somebody in your community may not be in your corner, but the Holy Spirit is in your corner. He is your friend. He is the greatest friend along with
thank
the
you,
Jesus,
Holy Spirit,
that you will ever have. He is with you. Amen. And I want you to listen to a song that speaks of how the Holy Spirit lives in us as white and tacky. This could not have happened without the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is our friend. The second word that came to me is the word I kind of like. It's the word determined. I sometimes say to people that have the privilege of being in. Remember, the California State Bar is the only bar that some kind of people can go to. Like my sermons, I'll sue you for severe detention, affliction, and emotional distress, so, but I'm only there. But the scriptures speak of him as our attorney or advocate in two different kinds of ways. One is prosecuting attorney. He is a prosecuting attorney. Jesus puts it this way in John chapter 16. When he comes, that is the Holy Spirit, he will prove the world to be wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. The world says, we don't need a Savior. The Spirit says, we need a Savior. The world says, Jesus was a mere mortal human being. The Spirit says, Jesus was raised in power and is the eternal Son of God.
Amen.
The world says, no one has the right to judge my conduct. The Spirit comes with conviction to do that very thing. He is the prosecuting attorney. But once he prosecutes the case and brings us to conviction and into salvation, then he becomes our defense attorney. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. Isn't that a marvelous word? The Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. That's not all. He helps us in our weakness. We do not know how or what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express, or with speech that does not have articulation. I personally believe the Spirit there, that Paul's words are referring to praying in the Spirit. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. The Spirit is praying through us in language we know and in language we don't know, because in the language we don't know, the Spirit is building us up in our faith. And speaking in the language of the Spirit is either the language of praise, as it was in Acts chapter 2, or it is the language of prayerful intercession. When I was a kid growing up on the China-Tibet border, my brother and sister are here tonight as well. We're three kids, three kids, up in the great northwest of China. My dad went out on a horseback expedition to reach Tibet. He's going to be gone a couple of weeks, and he came into one Tibetan encampment. Chief invited him. Into the tent, he ate a snack with the chief. Dad was just so excited because the chief had immediately given him permission to pass out gospel literature. When he left that encampment that late in the afternoon, he began to be very ill. As he rode his horse, he kept getting off and throwing up. And he threw up such a terrible green pile of dew that he had been poisoned. Late in the night, he tried to break the crystal of his watch to let my mom know what time he had died. Of course, there was no phone, there were no phones, no modern communication. But meanwhile, back at our home, my mother was awakened in the night and began praying for Dad. She didn't know why, but she interceded in language she knew and in language she didn't know. She didn't know. And a week later, when Dad came back and Mom greeted him, she said, "What happened to you?" And he described what had happened. At the time when she was praying for him, when the Spirit was interceding for her, through her, was the time Dad was fighting for his life. 30 days later, approximately a month later, some of those same Tibetans were in town, in the marketplace, and saw my dad. And they came over to him and they said, "Our chief gave you poison enough to kill 10 men. You must have a very strong God, and we want to hear more about your God." And one of my memories as a kid was those same Tibetans in our courtyard listening to the gospel. I never had problems with Mark's phrase, "If you drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt you," because my father was given enough poison to kill 10 men. But the Spirit caused my mother to intercede, and his life was saved. As our advocate, the Holy Spirit wants to pray through us. He wants to do what happened with Hannah of old when she was pouring out her her soul to the Lord. We need more of this in our lives and in our fellowship, of pouring out our soul to the Lord. Desperate times call for desperate prayers. Believers are under attack, suffering martyrdom. Marriages and families are disintegrating. Racial and ethnic conflict, disregard for the sanctity of life, destroying of the ancient landmarks of morality, abuse of children, resurgence of ancient religions, growth of secularism, many adversaries, many open doors. The Holy Spirit is calling for a generation of intercessors who will let the Holy Spirit be the defense attorney and intercede with us for our communities, for our